Okay. So 11th class, today we are starting with the chapter Landscape of the Soul. I have given you a brief introduction of the chapter in yesterday's class. This chapter is about various forms of art and how especially the Chinese art form varies from European art form, right? With few examples, with few instances, few stories, the writer Nathalie Clovery compares Chinese art form with European art form. Somewhere you will find things going out very much out of the box, very weird explanations, but then this is art. Art is creative, it can be unique, it can be weird, right? Chali, let's continue. Aditi, please read out the introduction also, Landscape of the Soul, written by?
Landscape of the Soul, written by Nathalie Clovery. The chapter is about how different the Chinese art form is from the European art form. The writer uses two stories to make a contrast. European art is about reproducing an actual view, whereas Chinese art is about creating a real landscape.
Yeah, please continue.
A wonderful old tale is told about the painter Wu Daozi, who lived in the 8th century. His last painting was a landscape commissioned by the Tang Emperor Xuanzong to decorate a palace wall. The master had hidden his work behind a screen, so only the emperor would see it. For a long time, the emperor admired the wonderful scene, discovering forests, high mountain waterfalls, clouds floating in an immense sky. Men on hilly paths, birds in flight. Look, sir, said the painter. In this cave at the foot of the mountain dwells a spirit. The painter clapped his hands and the entrance of the cave opened. The inside of splendid is beyond anything words can convey. Please let me show your majesty the way. The painter entered the cave, but the entrance closed behind him. And before the astonished emperor could move or utter a word, the painting had vanished from the wall. Not a trace of Wu Daozi's brush was left. The artist was never seen again in this world.
Now, somewhere we can say this chapter is less real and more fiction, right? Because a lot of description you will find which is absolutely out of the box, right? The opening of the chapter tells us about a painter named Wu Daozi, who was given a work to decorate the palace wall by a Chinese emperor, Tang Xuanzong, right? Now, this was his last painting. This was Wu Daozi's last painting. The painter did his work wholeheartedly, and it was a very different painting which was made. The painter hid his work behind the screen so that only the emperor would see it, right? The emperor, upon looking at the painting, admired many things into that painting, like discovering forest. The emperor found the forest were there. There were high mountains, waterfalls, floating clouds, men on hilly paths, and birds in flight. The painting was actually very beautiful, very different. The painter then pointed out that there was a cave in the painting, which was at the foot of the mountain. At the foot of the mountain, he had made a clay cave. And he said that this cave was guarded by a living spirit. As the painter clapped his hand, the entrance of the cave opened. Now, in real sense, you would say, how is it possible that in a painting there is a cave and the cave would open on clapping your hands, right? But then that was something different which Wu Daozi presented, right? This was something haunting, it was something mystical, God knows, but then yes, this is strange. So, as the painter clapped his hand, the entrance of the cave opened and he let the emperor know how beautiful the inside of the cave was, and he asked him to show all his to him. So, he asked him to show everything to him. The painter entered the cave and the entrance closed behind. The painter entered the cave and he asked the emperor to come in so that he can show it further. But before the emperor could enter the cave, the wall, the cave closed on its own. The emperor was greatly surprised, and immediately after that, the painting disappeared from the wall. After that, that painter was never ever seen again. So So this was something very strange. Somewhere it was scary, right? This is something we are talking about Chinese art, right? Chali, let's continue further.
Ma'am, your explanation is can you change?
Yeah, just a moment, just a moment. Just give me a second, please. Yeah, please continue. Such stories played an important part.
Such stories played an important part in China's classical education. The books of Confucius and Zhuangzi are full of them. They help the master to guide his disciple in the right direction. Beyond the anecdote, they are deeply revealing of the spirit in which art was considered. Contrast this story or another famous one about a painter who would not draw the eye of a dragon he had painted for fear it would fly out of the painting, with an old story from my native Flanders that I find most representative of Western painting.
Now, these stories play an important role in classical education in China. Similarly, like this, there was a book of Confucius and Zhuangzi, which have a lot many stories. These kind of stories are there. As they help the master to help and guide his followers in the right direction. Now, these stories were considered to be deeply revealing of the spirit, just like the art. They also had that spirit part, that ghost and the spirit guiding it, something that connected to it. So because of it, something strange every time happened in the story. There was another famous story in contrast to the previous one, where the painter didn't paint the eye of a dragon. He painted one eye, but he didn't paint the second eye of the dragon. He feared that if he painted that, the dragon would fly out from the painting. Right? So again, something very strange, somewhere horrifying, somewhere scary. It was one of the stories from many others, which came from a medieval country in Western Europe. So there were several other ones. Please continue. This is another.
In 15th century, Antwerp, a master blacksmith called Quentin Metz fell in love with a painter's daughter. The father would not accept a son-in-law in such a profession. So Quentin sneaked into the painter's studio and painted a fly on his latest panel with such delicate realism that the master tried to swat it away before he realized what had happened. Quentin was immediately admitted as an apprentice into his studio. He married his beloved and went on to become one of the most famous painters of his age. These two stories illustrate what each form of art is trying to achieve. A perfect illusionistic likeness in Europe, the essence of inner life and spirit in Asia.
Now, in 15th century, there was a master blacksmith by the name of Antwerp, right? A master blacksmith called Quentin Metis. In 15th century, Antwerp is the name of a place, is a city in Belgium. So in 15th century Antwerp, there was a master blacksmith by the name of Quentin Metis. This blacksmith, he was a blacksmith, not a painter, right? He fell in love with a painter's daughter. He was in love with the painter's daughter. Now, but the father, the painter didn't accept his love. So since the father was not accepting their relationship because of his profession, the blacksmith sneaked into the painter's studio. So he entered into the painter's studio and painted a fly on his latest panel. On his latest panel, he painted a fly. Now, painting was so real that the master tried to swat it away, fly it away. So the painting seemed to be so real to him that he tried to swat it away before he realized that it was just a painting. Means the picture was so real actually, it seemed as if it will fly away. So he started swatting it. The blacksmith was, because of this incident, the blacksmith was accepted by the painter for his daughter. He accepted him into the studio. But before that, he accepted him as a trainee in his studio. Then later on, he married the painter's daughter and became one of the famous painters of his age. So the two stories told above are trying to illustrate the form of art in two different regions. In Europe, the art is perfect. This is European art. The mosquito, the fly seemed to be so real that he was trying to swat it up. Right? That is European art. Is the art is perfect and like an illusion which resembles something. In Asia, the art gives an a sense of inner life and spirit. So you will find different stories of different places. Okay. Please continue further.
In the Chinese story, the emperor commissions a painting and appreciates its outer appearance. But the artist reveals to him the true meaning of his work. The emperor may rule over the territory he has conquered, but only the artist knows the way within. Let me show the way. The Tao, a word means both the path or the method, and the mysterious works of the universe. The painting is gone, but the artist has reached his goal beyond any materialistic appearance.
Now here the author is referring to the first story about the Chinese emperor and the famous painter. Here, what exactly it was that the artist was given, the painter was given to paint a wall by the emperor. Now, the artist knows the real meaning of his work. So, when he shows his work to the emperor only saw the outer appearance, the mountains, the waterfall, and everything. But it was the painter who said, see, there is a cave here at the mountain, and I know how to open up. And with his clap, he opened up the cave. Right? So the work was mysterious. And when he says, okay, I know the path, I know the method, Tao word here refers to the way, both the paths. So he says, I'll show you the path, I'll show you the method. Now, as the painting was gone, as he says, I'll show you the method, he enters in and the cave goes back. So the painting was gone after the artist reached the cave, means the motive was fulfilled. That some work was there beyond that materialistic appearance, which the artist knew and he reached that point. But that the emperor was not able to see that. Right? So that is Chinese painting, which has a totally different perception. Somewhere it is connected to supernaturals or spirits. Somewhere only the artist could understand what is behind it. The work is mysterious, obviously, but only the artist could find the path and the method. And for others, only the outer appearance. Please continue.
A classical Chinese landscape is not meant to be reproduced an actual view, as would a Western figurative painting. Whereas the European painter wants you to borrow his eyes and look at a particular landscape exactly as he saw it, from a specific angle. The Chinese painter does not choose a single viewpoint. His landscape is not a real one, and you can enter it from any point and then travel in it. The artist creates a path for your eyes to travel up and down, then back again, a leisurely movement. This is even more true in the case of the horizontal scroll, in which the action of slowly opening one section of the painting, then rolling it up to move on the other, adds a dimension of time, which is unknown in any other form of painting. It also requires the active participation of the viewer, who decides at what place he will travel through the painting. A participation which is physical as well as mental. The Chinese painter does not want you to borrow his eyes. He wants you to enter his mind.
Okay. Now this stanza clearly, giving the traits of both the form of art, so clearly discriminates how one form is different from the other. The Chinese landscape painting is not made with a real viewpoint. Chinese, there is nothing real. It's all fiction. It's all the artist's thoughts and what's going on in his head and heart that he tries to put in. Right? The Western painting in Europe is a figurative art form. The European painter paints a landscape to show you a specific scene of the landscape. The European painter wants to show you a specific scene. Right? Whereas a Chinese painter doesn't choose a real viewpoint. Chinese is absolutely fictional. It's not real. It's unreal. You can enter the painting from any point and can travel anywhere where your thoughts and imagination take you. That is a major trait of Chinese painting. From any point you can enter into the painting, from any viewpoint, and then you can take your imagination and thought that maybe with this point the painter has drawn, and he can take you to a different world altogether. So the Chinese artist wants you to travel by creating your own path, that means your own imagination, and then come out in a relaxed moment. In China, this mode of seeing a painting is more enjoyable. So China, Chinese people find it more enjoyable. A horizontal scroll is a form where one section of the painting is opened one by one by rolling it up to move out on the other side. That is a horizontal scroll. One by one, they remove the painting side, right? And because of which the author, the viewer, he starts developing his own imagination, what it is all about. It creates a dimension which is not practiced in any other form of artwork. It requires both mental and physical participation of the viewer. So the viewer has to mentally as well as physically participate for even viewing the picture, viewing the painting. The Chinese painter wants you to enter his mind and see the painting from his thoughts. So what, when he has drawn the painting, what imagination he had that he wants to show it to you. So the landscape created by the Chinese art is spiritual, inner and conceptual or abstract space. So I think that is very much clear, right? Chali, let's continue further.
This concept is expressed as Shansui, literally mountain water, which used together represent the world landscape, more than two elements of an image. These represent two complementary poles, reflecting the Taoist view of the universe. The mountain is yang, reaching vertically towards heaven, stable, warm, and dry in the sun, while the water is yin, horizontal and resting on earth, fluid, moist, and cool. The interaction of yin, the receptive, feminine aspect of the universal energy, and its counterpart yang, active and masculine, is of course a fundamental notion of Taoism.
Okay, now the Chinese concept of, please complete this stanza, but all together I can give the explanation. What is often overlooked is that?
What is often overlooked is as an essential third element, the middle void where their interaction takes place. This can be compared with the yogic practice of pranayama. Breathe in, retain, breathe out. The suspension of breath is the void where meditation occurs. The middle void is essential. Nothing can happen without it. Hence the importance of the white, unpainted space in the Chinese landscape.
Okay, the Chinese concept of art is also expressed as shanshui, which means mountain water. Now, the literary meaning of the word shanshui is a word which you must have heard several times. That means mountain water. It is used together to represent the word landscape. Now, the two contemporary poles of an image reflect the Taoist view. The mountain in the landscape is yang, which means to reach vertically towards heaven. Now, this is symbolic. Mountain means to reach vertically towards heaven, stable, warm, and dry in sun. Whereas the water is the yin, which is receptive and feminine aspect of universal energy. This is symbolism, what water stands for and what mountain stands for. And this question often comes in exam. So you can please mark it down. The yang is active and masculine and opposite of yin, right? So there is a third essential element, which is a middle void, which is a place where they interact. So first is mountain, second element is water. They are symbolic of yin and yang, what all they are. Yang is the feminine one, yin is the feminine one, and yang is the masculine one and most strong of it. Now there is a third element, which is the middle part, where they interact. The middle void can be compared to pranayama, which means to breathe in, retain, and breathe out. Pranayama is an exercise which we generally do. So middle void is also known as pranayama, that is breathe in and breathe out. Here the suspension of the breath is the void in this meditation process. Okay, so it is an essential part as nothing can happen without it. Hence, the white unpainted space in Chinese landscape is equally important. So please keep it in mind. Now, this stanza might confuse several of you. Chinese concept mein art is in two forms, that is yin and yang. Yin mainly is of mountains and yang is symbolized by water, right? Yin is the masculine and yang is the... Just a second, please. Yin is the receptive and the feminine aspect, sorry, and yang is the masculine and the most active one, right? Now, apart from these two factors, the third is the open space where all these activities take place. Middle void, and that is compared to pranayam. That is a comparison given to that activity space is pranayam, that is inhaling and exhaling of air, right? Just like that is important. So this outer space is important. That is the reason for every Chinese painting you will find unpainted white space. So this is also where the man finds a fundamental role in the space between heaven and earth. Now he becomes the conduit of communication between both the poles of the universe. His presence is essential even if it's only suggested, far from being lost or oppressed by lofty peaks. He is, in Frank Joyce Chuang's wonderful expression, the eye of the landscape. So two forces, yin and yang, one is the masculine, one is the feminist. The blank space is the middle void where the activities take place. It is compared to pranayam, right? Now, there is another person, that is human, is there, which is the in that space between heaven and earth. The human is there, which is a communication between poles of the universe. So his presence is very important because it's only suggested, far from being lost or oppressed by lofty peaks, that he is, in Frank Joyce Chuang's wonderful expression, he is the eye of the landscape, means his view is given, right? Chali, this is a bit complex, you need to understand. Please finish with the last stanza.
The middle here is where a man fights an important role. Man is the channel of communication in the space between heaven and earth, which are two poles of the universe. Man's presence is essential. It is not being lost or suppressed due to high peaks, but he is the eye of the landscape. Frank Joyce Chuang's expression.
Okay. Okay, with this, I have finished with the text reading. Just give me a second, please.